to us. She's got kind of some insight on what's happening that some of us don't. So she's going to share it with us. So. Okay. Hi, you guys. Good to be here.
Shake your hand if you're not comfortable with hug, but I think everybody got a hug.
Anybody else need a hug? But thank you guys so much for getting your way here. I know some are local, but a lot came for an hour away. In fact, you probably spent more hours driving than I spent getting here. So thank you so much for taking time out of your day, away from your family, braving the ice and snow and cold weather and being here. So give yourself a round of applause for making it here. I've been trying to fill like every seat in the house. If there's two more latecomers, we're in trouble. So that's really great.
I'll sit on the floor.
I know. Good problem to have. So before I dive into today's training, real quickly, how many of you, this is your very first regional, if you've never been to regional before? Okay. Welcome. Nebraska, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. How far is that drive for you?
About 3 hours.
Okay. But thank you for coming. Welcome. How many of you have been with Neora, Miriam Neora, a year or less? A year, just in your first year of your business? Okay. How many have been here for 3 years or less? 3 years? Okay. So everybody else is 3 years or more. How many have been here for 6 years or more? Hey, we made it. They started, so we've been here almost since the beginning. So good job, you guys. Okay, wonderful. And I know we have one guest in the room. Are there any other guests in the room?
No.
One guest. Okay. So for our one guest, Angie, I'm just warning. It might feel like I already pulled her in the car. It might feel like drinking out of a fire hydrant. I'm going to try to make it very palatable. Well, just real quickly, before I dive into our training for today, for those that we haven't gotten to meet, my name is Monica Dawson. I live in Dallas, Texas. My husband and I, John, are parents to three boys, ages 14, 13, and 10, almost 11, by the end of birthday. So very fun, busy, busy household, mom of all boys. People always say, are you going for the girl? I'm like, I'm the girl. There's only room for one princess, and so that would be me. And milking it. But, my background prior to doing direct sales is I was in medical sales, got into medical sales right out of college. I was very fortunate. That's my phone, so I'm going to turn that off. Please silence your phones. Starting with me. I got in medical sales right out of college, ended up going into cosmetic medical sales when I was like 26, almost 27. So I was going in selling devices that helped remove age spots and wrinkles and tighten the skin, shrink pore size, before I knew what any of those things were. You know? But all that's to say, I've kind of been obsessed with beauty and anti-aging. There's just, the world is so vast in what you can do to really just age gracefully. And so I was in that industry up until my third son was born. Our first two were 13 months apart. Our second two were 26 months apart. We figured out to stop drinking out of the same straw, so we slowed the factory down. But after my third son was born, I decided to step back from my career and become a stay-at-home mom. And about 8 months into it, somebody introduced me to the direct selling industry. It was a supplement that I started taking. It really made a difference. And they said, you can tell people about this and make money. And at that point, I was, don't take this wrong, I was a little bit bored. Very, very, very busy with little kids, but not intellectually stimulated. And so, because we were fine financially at that time, it wasn't an issue. But I decided, you know what, I'm going to do this. Most of my friends were spending their time scrapbooking and redecorating a room at a time, and then they'd go back to that. They decorate the whole house, and then they come back and start all over again. And I thought, that's an expensive hobby. And so I told my husband I can start a hobby that will make us money as opposed to costing me money. And guys, that is the vast majority of the people that either need the money or they don't need the money. But this can be a hobby that can be fun, can challenge them, but can be a hobby that earns as opposed to cost money. And so that's what introduced me to this industry. I did end up doing well. I just, you know, I'm kind of a go big or go home. I don't really know how to dabble in anything. And so ended up, you know, earning my investment back, earning a car, earning a trip with that company. And 8 months into the journey, we had gone on our first trip. And we were flying home, and I had met, like, normal, regular people who were earning, like, you know, professional athlete income. Like, stop. Is that real? Like, can you really do that? And they were not any more special than anybody else. And so my husband and I started designing a plan for him to quit his corporate job. He had a really great corporate job. And no joke, on a napkin, we were like, how much do we need to have in savings? What do we need to pay off so that you can let that go and just do this with me? And the next morning, from getting home from our trip, he got a phone call at 8 a.m. And they basically had done some restructuring, and his position was eliminated. It was like, wait, I wasn't on the napkin. We're not ready for that yet. And we weren't ready for it yet. And I would caution anybody who would love to make Peora a full-time income and go, you know, both husband and wife at it. Don't do that too soon, because you don't want to put stress on your business. It's so much fun when it's extra. It's not as fun when it's the only. And so, anyway, so we ended up getting thrown into this kind of whirlwind for the next few years. Thankfully, I started a plan B, so we had something to bridge us during that. But by the time I got introduced to Miriam at the time, I had done direct selling with some success, but not nearly enough to live off of. And I really didn't believe that I could do it. I mean, honestly, when this opportunity was brought to me, number one, I was extraordinarily skeptical. I mean, if you've ever handed somebody a bottle and they wouldn't even touch it, that was me. Like, not only would I not touch it, I wouldn't use free product. I just opened the box, closed it, and put it under my bed. I proceeded to try to talk everybody out of it that dared to call the prospect. I was that person that they call and they go, would you look at this? And they're like, sweetie, you should get yourself into one of those. You know, it's so cruel, and you hang up the phone and cry. I was her. You know, I was not nice about it. And so it took me about 8 months before I would even try the product. And the only reason I finally tried it is, one, I had lunch with a gal who had worked for a skincare company for 10, 15 years developing skincare products. And she brought up Miriam and was like, have you heard of this company? And I'm like, dang it, you too, you know? And then my mom's an esthetician, and I went to get a facial with her. And while I'm laying there, I'm like, Mom, watch this video. I mean, it looks like Hocus Pocus to me. And she watched it, and a minute into it, paused it and goes, can you get me a bottle? I'm like, really? And then she's like Miss Negativity. It was the last person I expected to be like, give me some. And then my husband calls on doctors, and he went in to see a doctor in Oklahoma, and he's talking to him about something else, and this doctor goes, hey, I have something I want to show you. And he pulls out Miriam. He says, this is the skincare product of choice, but I'm going to retire with what I'm making outside of my medical practice. You guys should get in. I'm like, stop it. Put a bottle under the bed, you know? So finally, to prove everybody wrong, I got it out and started doing my homework. And within a very short period of time, I had this sick feeling in my stomach, like I had judged this way too quickly. And so I called the guy who had sent me the bottle about 8 months early, 10 months actually by that point, 10 months earlier, and said, I'm ready, like I'm in. He's like, you're in jail, you're in, you know, what are we talking about? And so literally, I probably put the product on my face 2 times when I joined, which is ironic because most people that have any background in skincare, you would think, it's like if the product changes or makes changes for me, then I'll get involved, but that was not my posture at all. And so I jumped in. I did not have the money to join. Most people say I don't have the money to join, and what they really mean is they don't feel comfortable parting with what they do have. So they usually have access to a line of credit, or they've got a little kind of rainy day fund. You know, if they really don't have money, they usually do have some. I really didn't have money. Like, we had maxed out all of our credit lines. We had liquidated our 401k. I'm parking down to zero. Okay. We have a $40,000 loan out from my brother-in-law, and we had, my husband had just taken a new job. We had enough money in the bank to pay our mortgage for 60 days, which was when he was going to get his next commission check, except when he didn't know this when he took the job. If he didn't make quota, he didn't get a commission check, a bonus check of any kind. So so we weren't sure if he was going to make a quota in his first quarter because he was brand new. So we were like, or we get nothing January 1. So, I mean, I didn't have it. And thankfully, somebody believed enough in me to give me a loan. So I got started with a $1,000 loan to launch my business. And I had the gift of desperation breathing down my back to repay the loan. And so I got out the gate, shared the product with as many people as I could. I probably did in 1 week what most people do in a month, because that's what happens when you have the gift of desperation. I was able to pay back that loan. Within a few weeks, I qualified for the iPad, within a few months, qualified for a car. And I thought, okay, now I believe that other people can do it, so let me go out there and help other people do the same thing. And to say that in the last 6.5 years, our life has completely changed is an understatement. After the first year, we were able to retire my husband from his corporate job. What he did, he still worked, so he didn't retire and then kick up his feet and watch television. What he did is he started his own distribution business for medical devices. But, you know, that takes time. That takes years to build up. So he was able to kick that off. After the second year, we were completely out of all of our consumer debt. All of our debt was paid off. By our third year, we had paid off half of our home mortgage and retired my mom. By our fourth year, we were saving up for a second home, a property that many of the girls in the room have been to. We have a really beautiful lake house, an hour and a half outside of Dallas. Like, it's crazy. And just about 3 weeks ago, we just broke ground on what has been a childhood dream for me, which is on a swimming pool. And most people, I mean, I don't know, listen, y'all are in, you know, Kansas, so you may not care about a pool in your backyard, but literally, since I was that kiddo's age, I've been dreaming about having a pool. And I don't mean daydreaming. I mean, like, I would go to sleep, and in my dream, we lived in a house with a pool, or we were buying a house with a pool. I could right now draw for you 5 different floor plans of houses I dreamed of and what their pool looked like. Like, I had vivid, physical, vivid dreams of owning a pool. And so much so, I had a hard time justifying the expense, because in my neighborhood it's quite expensive. And so we've been like, yes, no, do it or don't do it. But so I wake up at least once a month having had a dream about a pool. And finally, my husband said about 8 months ago, he's like, why aren't we getting a pool? You've been dreaming about this since you were a little girl. You know, this is not for my kids. Most people put a pool for their children. I'm like, you people can use it. But so anyways, but I mean, it has been unbelievable. And it's not, let me be clear, it's not that Neora has paid for all of that. It has been the stepping stone, because what that income has done for us is it has freed us up to expand into other income streams and to take on some, you know, investments and things that the combined multiplied effect of all of those things have transformed our lives, totally transformed our lives. To be fair, I've been in this industry for 10, almost 11 years. How many of you, this is your first direct selling company? Okay, so just so you know, it takes some time to figure this thing out. It doesn't happen overnight. But it has been such an incredible blessing to our family. And we've been able to take care of so many other people. You know, just this last week, my mom's having car problems, and, you know, she called me all freaked out because, you know, she just found out that it's going to cost $3,000 to get her car fixed, and she just said, it's the worst news anybody could get. I was like, no, for sure. That is not the worst news anybody can get. I can think of about 100 other things you could have called and told me today. It would have been way worse than this. Here's the good news. I could stroke a check and fix your car. It's just not a big deal. Like, your blood pressure shouldn't even start to go up. We're good, you know? And it's so nice to be in a position that you can alleviate that stress from your mom, you know? And so, anyways, I hope you guys are ready, because what I want to do today, we'll do an overview, because if this is not your first regional, you've seen the majority of what we're going to talk about. But what I really want to spend our time going into today is the evolution in our compensation plan that just rolled out February 1. I really do believe that when it is all said and done, I'll talk to you about some skills that you can get better at that will help you to bring in more customers and bring in more brand partners. But I really do believe that the vast majority of your success lies in one word, and that is belief. It really all hinges on belief, because you can be awful at doing it exactly the right way, but if your belief is through the roof, people have a hard time dismissing it, right? And so fundamentally, it's just belief in three key areas. Belief in the products. The good news is our products are really easy to fall in love with. Whether you fall in love with one, two, or all 15 products, if you'll just to use the products and measure the outcomes, you're going to be a believer. You know, having been in and around the aesthetics industry now for a long, long time, I do believe we have best-of-class products. Not only are they amazing, in many cases they are just a step ahead of what's about to come out on the market, which is pretty brilliant. They're usually multifunctional, multitasking products. They hold to such a high standard that even the most discriminating consumers and even clinicians really can't critique them. So that's pretty amazing, because I will tell you, 99% of the direct selling companies are made up of selling products and services you can get anywhere. But you want to do your friend a favor and buy it from them. One of my mentors once called it, it's called money laundering amongst friends. You can get it anywhere, but if you get it from me, you're doing a good deed. Okay, that's not us. Our products are, in many cases, the only, or by far the best on the market. And all you've got to do is get somebody's attention long enough to try it, and they're easy to fall in love with. So, but if I write down right now, what is your belief level on a scale of 1 to 10 on our products? Let me say this. How many of you, well, I won't make you raise your hand because you might be mad at later. If you're constantly getting the injection of these products are too expensive, probably you've failed to relay the value of the product. Because price and value are always relative. So, in other words, if I say, you know, you can buy a car for $10,000, you'd be like, well, what car? They're like, well, it's a, whatever, 15-year-old Kia. You're like, well, that's ridiculously expensive. But if I go, well, it's a brand new, you know, Lexus, you're like, well, that's dirt cheap. So they're both cars. They're both going to get you from point A to point B. So to say a skincare product is expensive or a nutritional product is expensive is to put it out of context, because it's like, well, what does it do? Just so you know, my husband sells still devices into plastic surgery dermatology. Everything from dermal fillers to microneedling, PRP products, which do what's called the vampire facial. He sells body contouring products that drop fat and build muscle. The latest device that he has sells to the doctor for $180,000. They sell a package of four to the patient for $1,000 a treatment. People pay it all day long. Okay? Microneedling, which is what people use to shrink their pores, a microneedling treatment runs anywhere from $350 to $650 per treatment, and if you don't do three to five, don't bother. And aesthetic practices are exploding. Like, the number of new practices that open any given month in our just geography, my husband's like, well, there's another one, and there's another one, and there's another one. But just when you think, oh, people don't spend this kind of money on this, you're not talking to the right people. Because people spend money on what they value. Just to go in and get a little touch-up of Botox on your forehead is about $300, and you'll be back in 3 to 4 months. But if you're doing that, you're probably doing a little filler. And the filler is about $500 to $700 a syringe, and one syringe will do very little. So you're probably buying 2 to 3 syringes at a time. So most people are walking into these little mom-and-pop aesthetic practices and dropping thousands of dollars every visit, and they will be back in a few months. And they will forego taking vacations, and they will eat less to be able to have the money to do that. So if you've got a mental block about people spending money on this, you're not talking to people who value it, or you yourself don't value it. The number one objection that you're getting is probably your number one objection. It's a really fascinating. If you're broke, everybody's going to tell you it's too expensive because it feels too expensive to you. If you are short on time and you are having a really hard time doing it, everybody's going to tell you they are too busy to do it. if the number one objection that keeps you, holds you back, is probably the number one objection you're getting from your prospects. When I first started in the industry, a few months into it, I was getting the, oh, you're doing one of those things, you know? And so I went to the house of the guy, kind of the big leader in our market, and I sat down with him and his wife, and I was like, okay, what do you say when people say to you, you know, I don't, you know, it's one of those pyramid schemes, or I won't do network marketing, or I don't even have the verbiage anymore because that language is gone, so I'm having a hard time even telling you the story because that verbiage is so gone from my language, my vocabulary. But anyway, so I said this to him, and they said, nobody ever says that to us. I'm like, whatever. See, now you're lying. You know? Like, of course people say that to you, you know? And they said, no, I mean, they really don't say it to us anymore. So let me ask you a question. How do you feel about the fact that you're doing network marketing? I was like, what do you mean? They're like, well, are you proud of it? Are you a little embarrassed? I was like, well, I mean, listen, I came from the Hollywood of medical sales. I mean, if you're going to be in medical sales, first of all, capital equipment, no offense, beats pharma. I mean, in terms of like a hierarchy, pecking order. And then in the equipment side, cosmetic equipment, I mean, it is Hollywood. You know, you're dealing with beautiful people, a little twisted sometimes, but like, beautiful, you know. And so I did, psychologically, I felt like I had stepped down from a career, and I felt that way. And so when she said that, I realized I was calling people, and I would start with an apology, and then I would prospect them. It went something like, Cassandra, right? It's something like, hey, Cassandra, it's Monica, listen, not normally something I would ever get involved with, but I just got started with this company, and let me just tell you, the products are so good. I mean, I've always hated these pyramid things, but the products are so amazing. And she's already like, I'm not doing it. I mean, you might be able to, you know, scrape that under the carpet and not feel bad about it, but I'm embarrassed for you already. You know, every person I talk to, that's how I started. I felt the need to kind of preface it with, just so you know, I don't normally do this kind of stuff. And that should get your attention, because if I'm doing it, then it must be real. And it didn't. It was the opposite. It actually, I was putting forward my biggest objection, which is I was embarrassed that I felt like I'd stepped down from medical sales into network marketing. And so when she said that, I had to go take a big look in the mirror, and I realized, dang, I'm setting myself up, you know. And so I changed my language. I started researching the direct selling industry. I started building pride and confidence that I was in the right space. You know, and so just so you know, if your whatever your objection is the objection of your normal person. So I'll go back to the belief. So where do those objections come from? Your own and your prospects. Three categories. You. Okay. Are you worth it? Do you deserve it? Should someone partner with you? Right. You walk up to somebody who could be the next future rock star. Do you have the posture that, oh, you need to choose me as your upline? Because if you don't believe it, they certainly will not believe it. Right? So you, the products, and the business model. Those are your three categories. And every time you come to a regional, you hop into a training call, you should be building the belief in those one of those three categories. So when you're a 10 on a scale of 1 to 10, you'll recruit everybody you talk to. You can do it wrong, they'll join you anyways. Okay? So what I'm going to do with you today, so the U factor is an inside job. That's a 10 pages of a good book. That's associating with people who believe in you, who can build you up. You're the average of the 5 people you spend most time with. So, you know, choose your associations wisely. The products speak for themselves if you will use them. So you want to be using the products. But the last part is the business model. And so we're going to spend a lot of time on the compensation plan later, because I really believe one of the number one reasons people that used to recruit stop recruiting is they enroll people who didn't succeed, and now they feel bad, and they don't have the confidence to go put somebody else into that situation. So I'm going to show you how you can regain your confidence in that comp plan. Does that work?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I forgot to ask how we do the slides. I just hit the trigger. All right. So I'm going to do a quick overview of the regional slides, and then we'll go into the comp plan a little bit. I like to say in our business, the products bring you in to the company, because people try a product, they like it, right, so they come into the company. Once you're in the company, you start seeing the structure, the support, you know, the back office, the marketing tools, the events, the trainings and all that. And that all kind of makes you decide to actually join, to become a part of the company. But what keeps you from leaving the company, what shuts the back door, if you will, is this. It's called culture. It's a culture of authenticity, of character, of generosity, of giving back. How many of you would say that your Niora friends are much better for you, like they build you up and make you feel better about your life and your future than your non-Niora friends? You know, I remember working with a gal who was having a really hard time getting off Start, and she said, I'm just, the longer I do this, I'm realizing I have surrounded myself by such negative, unhealthy people. Like, I just never realized it until I saw the opposite. And so, if this were a club, you'd pay the cost of enrollment just to be a member of a club. I mean, seriously. And so, you know, I really believe this is who we are, and the who we are is the retention part of this, that keeps people a part of this company. Now, if you are, whether you are new to Niora or you've been with us for a while, I really encourage you to take this kind of reset on February 1 and treat it as a new start for you. And especially because there's so much new that, I mean, even I'm still discovering, which I think is really, really fun. But, you know, we have our new training in Niora.com/start. If you haven't been there recently, please write it down and just go every day and watch one of the videos, because they've put up an entirely new set of New Start videos, a great way to kind of get you kicked off in the new year, in the new Niora. But also, if you do it and you know what's there, you're going to be better at directing other people there. You're going to be able to tell them, oh, go to video two, and about 2 minutes in, what you and I are talking about right now is in about 2 minutes into the video. So if you do it, other people will do it, but I encourage you, let's everybody kind of kick off this new year and start with going to Niora.com/start, get out your Fast Start game plan, and rebuild that game plan. And so once we get over back to the recruiting section, we're going to talk about kind of doing another game plan. So hopefully you have a pen and paper, because I'm going to ask you to write some stuff down. By the way, how many of you were on the Zoom that I did last January? January, that's not. Oh, okay, a lot of you were. Okay, all right, good. So I won't do a full-on recap, because I spent a lot of time on that call talking about the recruiting cycle. So I won't spend a ton of time doing that. But if you haven't seen the new tarot sheet, everybody got a copy of it on their desk, on their part of it? Most people did. A lot of people did. Can I borrow your time?
Absolutely.
These are the new tarot sheets. You can print them now, but you can also order them in the back office. So the new tarot sheet has on there the All About Niora, which has all the company kind of stats and bragging rights. And then on the back, takes you through what is our new kind of roadmap, if you will, to earning back your investment. Although I'm going to show you an easy way to show that. And then it goes into your Fast Start game plan. And the Fast Start game plan always starts with the why. And, you know, when I started in this industry, having come from, that medical sales side, it felt very, like, warm and fuzzy and touchy-feely, this idea of, I have a why. You know, people would even introduce themselves with, I'd like to share my why with you. Like, what are you talking about? You know, because I'm like, can we just go and get it done? You know, like, I'm just a get-it-done kind of girl. I have a hard time stopping and doing this part. But the longer I do this, the more convinced I am that if you don't have a hot, burning desire, something in you that keeps you going, you will fizzle out fast. Okay, so as those of who've been here for any amount of time, you probably joined and wrote down your why. But my question for you is, when was the last time you reviewed and updated that? Because I know in my case, what motivated me the day I joined is very different from what motivates me today, 6.5 years later. And if you don't have something crystal clear that you are aiming for, something that's bigger than yourself, then it's just very easy to get off track. You get tired. You get worn out. People disappoint you. People who don't join, people who do join. Things happen in your business that are outside of your control. And it's just really easy to throw in the towel unless you have something so huge that it keeps you awake at night. And so if you haven't taken the time to do that, I highly encourage you to do it. In fact, I have a call on Monday morning. I've been doing it for years. It's called the Monday morning wake-up call. It's usually 15 to 25 minutes. We try to keep it short. Most weeks I'm on. Some weeks I have our team leaders on. But on our Monday wake-up call, apart from like a quick little shot in the arm, get you started, we're reading a book together called Living Forward. It's called Living Forward, A Proven Plan to Stop Drifting. Anybody by chance have their coffee?
Yeah, I have it.
Of course, dear. Okay, Living Forward, A Proven Plan to Stop Drifting and Get the Life that You Want. A little book, not a hard one. We're reading a chapter a week. Like if you bought it, you'd probably catch up to us by Monday. We're going very slowly through it. I'm not trying to rush through it. But even this week's chapter was about writing your obituary. Obituary. You're like, yikes. But what you're wanting to get to at the core is, what do you want to be remembered by? What about you do you want people to remember about you? Who do you want to impact? Apart from writing what people would say, it's specifically who would say what. Like, who are the important people in your orbit, and what would they say about you? Kind of an interesting thing to think about. But you bought it.
Well, I have that one, but this looks like that to you.
It does, writing your obituary. What is it?
It's called the Deathbed
Experience. Deathbed Experience, yeah. It is a scary thing. It is a scary thing, but I'll tell you, anything is going to get to the root of who you are and spark a fire for something that you can't shake. It'll be that. It'll be going, have I got my priorities right? Are the people that are most important to me going to say that I was the most influential to them? Critical. So I will tell you, I have found in times where I grow discouraged, I lose my way, I want to throw in the towel. Most of the time it's because I have lost sight of visibility on that. So if you feel that way, start with kind of getting in touch with that. You can grab that book, you can grab this one. But it's a powerful thing, and your why will fuel and you get the ability to get over it. I like to say that, you know, when you get that really crystal clear, it's like you've taken an arrow, tied a string to it, and thrown it out into the future as far as you can fathom. Because once you get the why down, then you begin building a day in the life, 5 years from now, or 10 years from now. And that becomes like an arrow you've thrown way into the distance. And now you're just making your way towards that goal. And it's not a straight line. Sometimes there's detours and there's ups and downs. But it becomes a guiding post. And, you know, I'm a parent to teenagers, you know, 13, 14 years old. And we went from like little kids to teenagers, and all of a sudden the issues that children deal with are like intense. You know, we went from I fell on my bike to somebody wants to kill themselves. You know what I mean? Like, what? You know, somebody threatened to shoot up the school. You know, it's like, wait, I'm not ready for those intense conversations, you know? And I have found my boys are very well grounded. And a big part of it is because I have used the philosophies I've learned in this industry to speak life and purpose into them. That when they're stuck in a moment, I can paint the picture of who they are and where they're going so that the moment doesn't consume them. Well, when I talk to parents of kids that are really off track, the number one thing they're missing is vision for who they are. They have no idea who they're becoming. And so they have no purpose at all. They're just aimlessly wandering. And so they're bored, they're getting into trouble, and they're trying to get identity and all of this. And what if all this wasn't just for you? What if all the personal development you're going to do to improve yourself so you can get what you want out of this journey? What if all the books that you read, all the calls that you get on, all the events that you come to, what if it didn't grow your paycheck, but you were able to influence and change the lives of people around you? Would that be worth more than the money?
Yeah.
And I can tell you, I mean, I feel so prepared to deal with this with my children. And I find my children are rising up and helping other kids get out of their school because they're going, man, you got purpose. God has a plan for you. Like, you shouldn't stay where you are. And it's beautiful to see this unfolding, but If you feel aimless, get this and get clear on your why and a plan of action to get you there. Yes, Nick.
What time is your phone call on?
Oh, sorry. 10:30. 10:30 Central. 10:30 Central. And by the way, if you miss the live call, you can call back and just change the last digit to a 9, and you can catch the replay. It's immediately available. I have an unlimited line, so you can invite anybody you want to invite to it. Yeah. Let me tell you, this call has been really good. It's been good for me. I don't know about my team, but it's been good for me. It keeps me on track. So we try to talk about what's relevant and in the moment. We don't determine the topic until days before, sometimes day of, because we try to be relevant with what's going on right now. So, okay. Okay, I'm going to zip through some of the obvious stuff, but I felt like that was important, especially we are at the beginning of the year, for you to get that crystal clear as we go into this transition and really rebuilding your business. So once you've got that crystal clarity on the why, now you've got to be willing to put the activity behind it to correspond to the desire. Okay, so I was reading a book. There's a great book. It's just kind of more like a handbook for direct selling. It's called GoPro. By Eric Worre. You've probably all read it. But in the chapter on launching a new distributor, he says that, you know, the first thing I do is sit down and figure out what the person wants, and then I ask them, how many hours per week are you willing to put in to achieving that objective, and for how many years are you willing to do that? Right out the gate. Because if somebody's desire doesn't match their willingness to contribute activity, then something's got to change. So we got to modify the desire, the goal, or we got to modify your activity level. It's kind of got to be the same, right? And so this is the what we're doing to grow your businesses every day. And we talked about belief in self, products, and business. And these are how you build belief in those categories. Completing a new rep partner training. If you haven't done the new one, go and do it. Doing your exposures every day. Going out there and sharing the products with people. Introducing them to the business model. We'll talk about that. Attending weekly market parties, Nerium universities, Neora University trainings, regionals. Who's going to Nashville? Oh, I love it. If you're not, don't put your hand up. You better put your hand up. Somebody next to you is going to drag you to Nashville. Hide in the corner because everybody's going. This is fantastic. But these are all belief building. I mean, you can't quantify the value that comes from that. And then, committing to personal development, getting a workout partner, a group of people who are going to encourage you and push you, and be here a year from now, be here 5 years from now. This is not a one-year journey. It's a five-year journey. And in fact, about 4 years into my five-year journey, I put a sticky note on my desk in front of me. I was like, it's a 10-year journey. It's a 10-year journey, and I'm going to enjoy it. I'm going to have life balance. I'm going to get there, but I'm going to have a relaxed intensity about it. And so I'm just, 6 years into a 10-year journey. Goal settings, we talk about the setting the arrow out into the future. Apart from that, it's setting a monthly objective, which you break down into weekly objectives, which you break down into daily objectives. The best daily objective I have seen is 2 a day. Just introduce or follow up with 2 people a day. Anybody can do that if you've got a busy lifestyle. And we'll talk a little bit about the recruiting side, but the 2 a day is a great kind of meter for getting you towards your objective. With the launch of the new compensation plan, I've got a goal for you that's going to be your February goal. So we'll talk about that here in a moment. What's phenomenal, so many things I love about the new comp plan, but one of the many things I love is they've broken down the compensation plan in such a way that you can truly lily pad your way to success. It used to be that from getting from here to there was this massive leap. And now what they've done is they've broken it down into lily pads. And when people feel successful, they do more. And when they do more, they get more. So this comp plan psychologically is going to shift behavior. It's going to take 90 days before you really see the impact of the comp plan. So just know for the next 90 days, it feels a little wonky. We're still growing into our new clothes. It's going to take 90 days before you see this compensation plan really come to life. And the 2 a day. This is the 2 a day promotion system. I went into great depth last month on this. I live and die by this plan. write down the three questions that I think if this, I'm not going to go into this again. I'm going to talk about what I think are the three questions you people are asking when they're determining whether or not they're going to join you. I'm not talking about customer acquisition. I will talk about customer acquisition when we get to that comp plan. This is a recruiting conversation. In my experience, if you don't aim to recruit, you won't recruit. In other words, if you're only aiming for customers, recruiting is much harder than if you're aiming to recruit and as a byproduct you get customers. Okay. So in the two-day promotion system, it's taking people through a series of exposures, 5 to 7 exposures before. Anybody not know what an exposure is? An exposure is simply an event that moves you from not knowing to knowing. An exposure can be a sample, a video, a conversation, a presentation, a magazine, a new tool that adds new knowledge or experience that moves you forward in the cycle. Okay. But there's three questions that this exposure is intended to answer. Okay. One, do I like the products? Two, can I see myself doing the business? And three, is it worth it? Those are the three questions. And every other question is a sub-question of those three questions. And I see this so clearly that every time I talk to somebody, a prospect, or I'm doing a three-way call, or I'm talking to a brand partner about, you know, somebody that's on the fence, and I probe them, I can delineate from everything they say whether the objections are centered around the products, around the how-to of the business, or around the money. Those are the three buckets. And on a rare occasion, you get somebody who is a purely business decision. Maybe they've done direct selling before. They believe in the model. They're like, show me the money, and if I like the money, then I'll go fall in love with the products. Those are called professionals. Because, by the way, that's how all of us accept jobs. I mean, I don't know how many of you work for a company that has a product or service that you yourself are not a consumer of. But you still work there, right? So in our business, though, the typical person tries the product if they get excited about it. Doesn't have to be from personal experience. They can get excited about it from intellectual knowledge, right? So if they get excited about it, then tell me what I would need to do to be successful at this. And if I do that, what are the rewards? That is the typical cycle, okay? I'm so convinced of that when I do a three-way call, if I know that they are stuck on the product stuff, I don't even go into anything else other than like a hint about what's available if they love the product. But until they love the product, everything else is a moot point. Okay? And so what I'd like to do, actually, I've got one person who I already asked last night. Oops, where are you?
Jill.
There you are. I'd actually like to, Jill and I were doing this last night, so I'd like to do this, and then I'm going to have one more person after I get done with Jill. So I want you to think about somebody right now that's in your pipeline that's stuck, and I just want to talk with you about where they are. I want to just kind of give you an example so I can help you delineate this. So, hi, Jill, how are you?
I'm good.
Yeah. Hey, have you all know Jill?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so Jill, tell me about one person that you've been prospecting for a while that you kind of want to get off the fence.
Well, I met with Katie for lunch, and she loves the products, and she just says she just wants to use the product. She doesn't really want a lot of information, you know, at this point. I think she's afraid that she's gonna like it, but she doesn't know where it's gonna take her.
Okay, so and let me back up real quick. How do you know Katie?
Me and Katie did network marketing back years ago when our kids were young.
Okay, so she knows about network marketing.
Yeah.
Okay. And you've sampled her the product?
Yes.
What product?
She does the Prolistic. She does the Choose.
Does, as in, is she a customer?
Yes.
Okay, she's, how long has she been a customer?
Two months as a customer.
2 months as a customer. And she's on the Choose, Prolistic, and something else?
She's doing the night cream.
Okay, so she's spending about $275 a month. Okay. What does she do for a living?
She does nails out of her home.
Okay. So when you think about her, why do you think she would be a good brand partner?
Because she, I like her.
That's a great place to start, because it is easier to recruit a new person than to fire a team member.
We love
only recruit people you like.
We love doing things together. We have done that before. And her, I know that she has a good personality, and she's got good connections.
Okay. So, on a scale of 1 to 10, specific to the products, how convinced is she of the products that she's using that she likes them?
I'm going to estimate 5 to 7.
5 to 7. Okay. So, that's not a 10.
No.
Okay. All right. So, she's not a 10 on the products yet. So, that's not that she has to be to, for you to go to the next step, but she likes the products, but she's not convinced they're working necessarily.
She's not. I don't feel that.
Okay. I mean, has she taken her before and after from the night cream?
Yes.
Okay. Was there an appreciable change?
Yeah. She has a lot of inflammation, a lot of redness in her skin. And she was using another wash because she liked the smell of it, and it was a citrus smell. And when she does put the night cream on, it does soothe her face. And I'm saying, well, the citrus may be
irritating
your skin. And so I know you love the smell of it, but I did give her a sample of the wash.
Great.
And she does like it, but why do people use things that irritate their skin and then they say that our products don't work?
Because their dermatologist told them to. Okay, so let's moving through the questions. Do I like the products? Can I see myself doing the business? Is it worth it? From what you've told me, we're on our way to gaining her confidence on the products. Probably she doesn't have confidence in her skin, not confidence in our products. She's not confident that if she could stand up in front of somebody, she would be a great representative of the skin cream. But that would be my guess. I bet if you were to dig a little deeper, she's probably self-conscious.
I believe so.
Okay. So, on our way, what does she know about the how-to on the business model? What have you, did you take her through the process?
I took her a little bit through the process.
So, let's go through the process. You sampled her product. She became a customer. What third-party tools has she seen?
She has seen a lot of videos, Zooms.
So she's done some presentations?
Yes.
Okay. Obviously, you've talked to her quite a bit because you followed up with her. Have you introduced her to anybody besides you?
I tried. She shut me down.
She shut you down. Did you say, I'd like to introduce you to somebody?
Yes.
Okay. So don't say that.
As I was sitting with her on lunch,
right?
You know, I actually got a phone call. Her mother. And so I kind of, you know, worked that in, and Heather didn't know I was having lunch. She didn't know I was sitting there having a margarita. You know, I think she's going to think that I'm going to talk her into it. And I don't want to talk her into it.
Right.
That's the last thing that I want to do is talk. Because if I talk her into it, then I have to prodder to work, and I don't want to do that.
So, you are correct. If you ask her if you can put her on a call with somebody, she assumes you're bringing in the closer. You're 200% correct.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's how I want you to think about three-way calls, all right? All right, so first of all, what your prospect thinks a three-way call is and what it really is are two different things. And what your prospect thinks it is the closer. Mm-hmm. So, it would be like as if we said, hey, your goal is to go out and earn the Lexus. So this weekend, I want you to go to a dealership and drive the model that you want. Just kind of get a feel for how it feels driving it so you can get a real vivid picture and put it on your dream board. So you go to the dealership, you're like, I'm going to buy this car and I want to test drive it. And you get out the test drive and you come back and the guy's like, hey, let me go grab the manager. You're like, no, I'm not buying today. And you book it. Like you leave before the manager makes it out of his office. Because you're not buying a car today. You're just thinking about it. You're hoping one day you can. So that's what your prospect thinks a three-way call is. But that's not what it is. Let me ask you a question. How many of you do this business in a vacuum completely and entirely by yourself? Well, yes and no. I mean, you're here. Do you know what I mean? Like, my point is, yes, what you do on your own is what matters. But success is based on the support of a team structure, right?
So if you were taking a job in an office, you would go through a process of interview. You would find out, first of all, what company's hiring. What's the name of the company? What product or service do they do? How do they compare to the other competitors of that same product or service, right? Then you'd want to know, what position are you hiring for in the office? I mean, are you hiring for an executive assistant? Are you hiring for a sales director? Are you hiring a marketing manager? Or am I going to be in packing? You know, what position? And who am I going to be reporting to? Right? Who's going to be my manager? What's the reporting structure? And then if I accept the job, what are you going to pay me? What's the offer? Correct? It's the same when we're recruiting for this. Same. They need to understand the product and the company. They understand the position and what it entails to be successful. They need to meet the people they would be reporting to or partnering with. And then you tell them what the pay is. And they either accept or decline. It's just easy. So if you, first of all, if you ask to put them on a call, the answer's no. So I don't ask to put somebody on a career call. I say, hey, I'd like to catch up with you on that sample. Or there's some new exciting stuff going on at Neora. If you have 10 or 15 minutes, we can hop on the phone. I want to update you. Okay, so this is somebody who's been in your pipeline. The answer is, yeah, sure, 10 or 15 minutes. You've got an appointment. Then you find the person who's going to do your three-way call. You bring them onto the line. You give them a few tidbits about where they stand. And then when you bring her on the line, you go, hey, listen, I know you've been kicking this around for a while. And for me, a big part of my success is who I'm working with. So I just wanted to introduce you to somebody that if you did decide to move forward, they would be really important in helping you be successful. That's all you're doing. This is not a convincing. How many of you actually do three-way calls for other people as in you're the expert? Just a few of you. Okay, I do want to write something out for you, which I think is very important if you were doing three-way calls. And by the way, any of you can do a three-way call. Any of you could be the expert on a three-way call if you've been with this company for any amount of time. The only prerequisite for being an expert on a three-way call is you love the product, you love the company, and you're going somewhere. You're not negative Nelly. If that's the case, you're a great candidate to do a three-way call. But so remember we talked about, right? People like the products. Can I see myself doing the business, or is it worth it? Okay. So on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being, you know, they don't even know the name of the company. That's an awful straight point. Okay. So 1 being completely have no knowledge of anything at all. 10 being, how come you haven't signed me up yet? Right? I find when people are a 1, 2, 5, you should be focused on the testimony. When you're the expert, you should focus on the testimony. This isn't really about telling them stuff. It's about validation. So it should be a testimony validation call. What are you validating? The product? The business model? And the success you've had? Why? Do I like the product? Can I see myself doing the business? Is it worth it? Okay? If they like, how do you like the product? Oh, I love it. I'm getting all kinds of compliments. When I start the call, I don't know when I start the call what I'm going to do. Okay? So, how long have you known Jill? Oh, we've been friends forever. So, tell me where you guys are so far. What have you guys done? You tried the products, great. How are those working for you? I love it. Okay, awesome. So, has Jill talked to you about kind of what it would look like to get involved with the company? Well, yeah, maybe. I don't know. I'm very busy. I've got a job. I've got 3 kids. I don't know if I can really, you know, I don't have much time to do this. And, I mean, you know, $500 is a lot of money. Okay, so immediately they've thrown out objection of time and money, right? So once they're done talking, I ask a bunch of questions. Once they're done talking, then I say, in my experience, there's only 3 questions. Do I like the product? Can I see myself doing the business and is it worth it? Those are the 3 questions. Sounds like you like the product. Do you have any questions about the product? No. Okay. Let me talk to you a little bit about the business model. You know how Jill contacted you and gave you a sample? Yeah. Did you do that? Yeah. Okay. You know how Jill, after she gave you samples, sent you a video, maybe introduced you, put you on a Zoom presentation that you learned about the company and the business and so forth? Could you invite people? Yes. Okay. You know how afterwards she introduced you to Ray Lynn and, you know, she was telling you about how much she loved the product and what success she's had? Yeah. That's it. That is the business. They're like, really? So all of a sudden, they're like, oh, so what she did is all I have to do. Let me tell you, if you do it with them the way they're going to do it to others, answering question two is easy. If you didn't, it's hard. And if your process doesn't include a third party, it's you, they're out. Because the number one thing people say is, I will never do to other people what you are doing to me right now. I literally had somebody say that to me when I first started the industry. That's how awesome I was. I was not a natural. I mean, my first day with my first company, they had a blitz day of calls, and it was like, you're going to just gap people. Like, what's that mean? Like, get a pen. So I'm calling people like, get a pen. But I couldn't do that. I had to be like, hey, listen. So I just started doing this thing, and you know me. I'm not that girl. I would never do anything like this. However, and then I went into a 30 to 45 minute presentation, which you should never do. And I get to the end, and people go, whoa. Man, you are excited. You're going to do awesome. It is not for me. Because I could never be that excited. And so it was click, click, 15 no's in my first day. And I was aggressive. Okay. In fact, I'm not even sure if I got one yes. But 15 no's in my first day. And I'm like, come on, Doug. I have an opportunity. You know? So I wasn't like shy about it. I wasn't, you know, pussyfooting around. I was getting after it. One of the gals, I did get her on the phone. I talked to her for 45 minutes. I was going to Arizona. I told her I wanted to meet with her. Turns out she had a migraine that day. I blew up her phone telling her why our product was amazing for migraines. She was sitting in a dark room trying to shut the world out, and her phone was buzzing like crazy because I was neurotic. She wouldn't respond. I sent her a sample. She didn't acknowledge she received it. Next time I went to town and tried calling her, she ignored me. And finally, I called her one time from my home phone. And she didn't know the number. So she didn't know to filter that call. And so I answered. I was like, hey, it's Monica. She's like, oh, hey. Like, you know. And I'm like, oh, she's like, very surprised. It was me, you know. And after I was like, look, don't you just be so awesome at this? You can earn $1 million. I was like, you know, you're going to be rich. It's going to get rich quick, and you're going to get rich because you're awesome. And that's basically what I was saying to her. And I stopped talking, and she goes, Monica, I don't know how else to say this to you. No. The answer's no. And in fact, if you were to tell me I would be a millionaire in my first year, the answer's still no. And even if you were to tell me I could, like, buy my family a house in the Bahamas, the answer's still no. And even if you told me this thing cures cancer, it's still no. Because she said this, I just simply cannot do to other people what you've done to me. She flat out said it. I'm like, you are actually smart enough to know exactly what I'm doing wrong. And I hadn't figured that out just yet. So she said, I will not do to other people. And she said, I never in a million years do to other people. I was like, whoa. So I have to chill out, you know? So I'm honestly, the number, when people like the product and they desperately need the income and they won't join your team, you should look in the mirror. I'm just being honest. That's something I can say in a group setting. If I said it to you one-on-one, you might slap me. But you should look in the mirror. And I say that as someone who had to look in the mirror. Because what they're really saying is, what you're doing right now, I'm not going to do it. I'm just not going to do it. I'm not going to overnight become like this, like, maniac, neora, you know, fanatic. I'm just not going to do it. I'm not going to work as hard as you're working. I'm not going to be as, you know, crazy about it as you are. I'm going to have a life beyond it, honestly.